Hello, everyone, and welcome to a very special episode of Blue Tengu's live game development show, where we show everything that goes into making a game from concept to completion. Not special as in anyone gets killed to teach you a valuable moral lesson, but the kind of special that comes with doing something for a whole year. Yes, that's right, it's our 1 year anniversary. Sorry to keep you guys waiting, just some of the preparation took a little longer than expected, but that's a lot of the way now. A year ago, yes. At least in Japan right now, it's the 4th of July. And PandaBits is saying, "What the hell?" I hope this is going okay. Not the kind of special where you kill someone. Okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. We'll see how it goes as the show goes on. But yes, in Japan, it's the 4th of July right now. Unfortunately, I guess in the States, it's the 3rd of July, which is not quite as special. There were fireworks going off outside. Japan isn't particularly keen into celebrating the independence of America from England, so not entirely sure why the fireworks were going off, but it fits. A year ago, the reason we kicked it off on Independence Day, was because we thought it was a good time to kick off Blue Tengu, because it's the 4th of July for me anyway. It's special, so independence and all that's the ultimate goal. Anyway, this episode, it is special. I'm going to make it to celebrate the 4th. I'm going to make it a special 4 hour episode, with my usual chatting and voice dying at about the 2 hour mark. This should be very interesting. The last 2 hours might be me just like trying to scratch out a voice. And yes, definitely, it's 4 hours, so don't feel obligated to stick around that long if you have things to do, obviously. And interesting chat colors here. Beaveronics, thank you for jumping in the chat. Yes, it is like 8 a.m. over here in Japan. So why are there fireworks going off at 8 a.m. in Japan? I have no idea. It's weird. That's the last thing I would have expected, but maybe someone's celebrating for us. But anyway, because it is the 1 year anniversary and we've got something else special, yes, we're gonna launch Project Spaghetti today. But to kind of talk about what we did a year ago, I first got the idea for Blue Tengu from, of all things, writing novels. About 5 years ago, I completed my first National Novel Writing Month challenge, and I've been doing it every November ever since. It was one of those things where, once you get through the pain of writing a novel the first time, which is very painful, it gets easier. And I wanted to see if I could take some of that pain away when it came to game development. At least, if you guys see me doing it, maybe realize, hey, it is possible. If this guy can do it, certainly we can do it. And I knew before I came into the game industry 10 some odd years ago, whenever it was, I can't even remember, making a game just seemed like a gargantuan task. I made a couple of piddly games, like back in high school and college and stuff, just in my free time, but nothing commercial, nothing like that until actually jumping into the game industry. And ever since then, I've always been like helping teams out and things like that. So I've always just been, one small part in the giant working machine. So I haven't ever had control of like the big picture or anything. And I'll admit game development still is a gargantuan task, as we'll go over today. But people do it. The key, like anything else, I guess, is to divide big goals into small goals and chip away at the things that have the most value and, could lead to the most risk first. But Project Spaghetti, which is what I chose to work on the first season of this show, the top-down 2D cowboy shooter where the bullets fired bounce around the screen with the pinball mechanic, has a lot of basis in my love of the Commodore 64. Not sure how many of you have actually played with that system or not. It was a long time ago, I guess. Even for me, I am old, but I'm not so old where I just, had a Commodore 64. Or I was the owner. It was my brother's. If you see him in the chat, Jamorian is basically my brother, and he does, Kerbal streaming and things like that. But he's the one that had the Commodore 64, and so that's how I had access to it. But it's my favorite system of all time. It's the Commodore 64 is why the colors are the way they are. Why I've always restricted myself to that that 15 color palette. There's 16, but one's for transparency, so it's just 15, really. And it's also why the gameplay focuses on just one mechanic and tries to just test that in a lot of different ways. Even if I do have more modern game bits inside, it's still at heart kind of a Commodore 64 game, kind of a lost Commodore 64 game. There are people out there that actually literally make Commodore 64 games now. I didn't go that far. But, on the Commodore 64 games like Mr. Do, Mr. Do's Castle, Cops and Robbers, obviously High Noon, all of those had an influence, all had a hand in influencing me with Project Spaghetti. Mr. Do, the way that we'd throw the ball and it'd kind of bounce through the maze and stuff like that until it came back to you, couldn't fire again. Obviously, it's not that kind of game, but all these little things. With Mr. Do's Castle, it was the way the enemies change over time and get harder. Cops and Robbers, it's all about. Yeah, with Cops and Robbers, it was all about, like, there was the safe on the first floor, second floor. There's this safe, and there was this combination that would change every time, and it's like you'd have to go through these dark corridors and all these different things to find the key to unlock the safe, and that's the ultimate goal, obviously. If you're the robber, you're not the cop. So, but things like just that adventure aspect of finding the key. Well, even going back to the Atari 2600, adventure, finding the gray dot and doing all that stuff to get the Easter egg. Secrets, love secrets, so that had a big influence on me. Dropping keys everywhere, locked out houses, chests, all that kind of stuff. And I sprinkled a lot of secrets into Project Spaghetti. And, I'm really looking forward to the day when people start finding them all. But, let's get right into it. Obviously my prep work is a little behind schedule, but I think I managed to get everything properly public and working and everything else. So, yes, and Panovitz did mention someone out there is an early riser. Yes, that's actually a big part of this show. The reason I'm doing it at 8 a.m. as opposed to like a more normal, reasonable weekend time, normal human being weekend time, is because the same thing. It's from the novel writing stuff. If the secret I found to actually getting a novel done in a month is to actually do it in the morning, do the work in the morning, because I did start, the first time with a couple of other people, and then none of them finished. And the reason was they all tried to do it after work, after all their other obligations. And the problem is things always come up. In the morning, you're in control. You decide when you wake up, you decide the first thing you do before people start talking to you and interrupting you and asking you to do this, that, and the other. So morning is the best time to do it. That's why I chose 8 a.m. Because normally in my life, unless I've had some very good reason, I've never been awake at 8 a.m. on Saturday morning, so it's a bonus time, I guess. It's also why I'm sleepy a lot during the show. But yes, that's why. And Panovitz says the Commodore 64 was long before your time. It's it is a shame, because a lot of people are gonna wax nostalgic about old game systems and things like that, and how the old days were better and all that. I'm definitely not gonna say that. Things like Assassin's Creed and Batman and things like that, they're awesome. Couldn't have had those on the Commodore 64 or Atari 2600. But one thing those games did have, or those systems did have, was because they were so limited, there's very little you could do on them in terms of, well, you've seen me work in Project Spaghetti with like 15 colors and limited resolution and all that sort of stuff. But the thing about it is, like, for example, the reason Project Spaghetti is one game mechanic is because you couldn't squeeze all this other stuff in there. You couldn't rely on, Final Fantasy style CG movies. You couldn't rely on, even Sewer Shark style full motion video back then. You couldn't rely on much of anything except for the actual game. Things, even going back further than the Commodore 64, things like Joust, for example, one of my favorite games of all time. Obviously, the levels change, but when you boil it down, for example, if you look at the sprite sheet for Joust, there's very little involved. There's probably like the edge of the left edge of the platform, right edge of the platform, middle of the platform, the little gray spots, and then you've got your sprite, enemy sprite, and a pterodactyl sprite, and a couple of variations of that for animation. and eggs and things like that, but there's not much involved. But you know, it's one of those games that I can play over and over and over again. I've probably picked it up on like every system that it's come out because I love Joust, but that's it's one of the things that's like you can't do much with the system, so you focus on trying to make one game mechanic really good. So a lot of like modern games, the core of them, FPSs aside, the core of a lot of modern games came from like the Atari era, the Commodore 64 era, Nintendo era, things like that. Obviously, Nintendo is still to put I can't think of another word to put it, but you know, it's a bad word, but milking. It's not milking. It's using. But you know, they're still Mario is still in their game. Zelda is still in their game. So you know, with that era, there wasn't a lot you could do. So obviously, it forces you to focus on a game mechanic that's really interesting, catches people's attention. So that's why I like that era. There were a lot of games like that. Developers were forced to kind of do that. There's a lot of junk too. Let's not put on the rose-colored glasses. There was a lot of junk from that era too, but a lot of good stuff came out of it. And Jamorian drops by. Hey Jim, I'm not sure if you heard it, but talked about your Commodore 64 and how your Commodore 64 has inspired me on Project Spaghetti, and we're launching Project Spaghetti today with a 4-hour 4th of July special. Happy 3rd of July, yeah, I guess, since you're in the States. But Pandabit said your game can't have 11 hours of cutscenes, but then what are we supposed to do during the game? Play it. Yeah, exactly. And before I even do the launch trailer, for example, I should describe the price point. I was waffling on the price back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth for weeks and weeks and weeks, and even this morning. It's one of those things where it's hard to set a price because modern games are very different. You know, it's because it's a game that focuses on a gameplay mechanic and getting points and things like that. It's not using a lot of the things that other games do to try and like, you know, carrot stick people through the game. So for example, there's no, you know, there's no story, cutscenes, things like that. There's none of this like level up your character with just random like number tracking and stuff like that. Yeah. So, you know, part of me thinks, you know, it's not gonna be one of those games that can compare to like, you know, the 999 type games. Obviously didn't make it with a team or anything. But at the same time, it's like, well, you guys have seen the show. You know how much work has gone into this. it's not one of those things I want to undervalue either. It is a fun game. It is good. I think, you know, obviously I'm the one saying it, so it's not take it with a grain of salt, but it's a fun game. And I like it. It's one of those games that it's fun to play through again and again. Like I was trying to go for that Joust kind of thing for me, you know, where it's like you want to come back to the game once in a while and, you know, see how high you can get your score and things like that. There's no multiplayer, there's things like that. So obviously price point was something I was waffling on, but you'll see when I show you the site what the price point is set at. But let's premiere this game. Let's premiere it with let's all right, let's just queue it up. So I'm gonna show the ad and let's see what I do next. I'm gonna have to do a couple of things today. Well, I'll show the ad first and then I'll go over what I'm gonna do today in that 4 hours until my voice gives out on me. So here we go. And there we have it. Just so you don't lose that link. Let's put this up. There we go. Now you don't get to see my neck. So there we go. That took a lot of work to edit. And there were a lot of things behind it. But one of the things that happened this week, it's going to be a special that'll come up later, but I'll go over some of the snafus that have happened over the last year here. One of the snafus that happened to be this week. Went through, spent the whole day recording footage, trying to get it just right so things kind of linked up and the video flowed together. And when I put it together and rendered it out, it looked awful. It's like, wait, what just happened? Found out the bit rate on the original recorded video that I did was really, really low. It's the same bit rate, like for example, I use for the Twitch stream, so I don't like burn your computers basically when I stream. And it's not good for making trailers. So I had to spend another day getting footage at a higher rate. Thankfully, the second day went faster. But yes, that was one of the snafus. But thank you, Jim and Bironix, for the compliment on the video. I do appreciate it. It is up on YouTube as well. I think I published it a little early before the show, so maybe some of you saw the announcement there if you were on YouTube. But there we go. We've launched. Let's see. I can't quite see the screen. I hope my border is okay, but I should have the link over there. It's itch.io. Let me take you over there. Let's get the Project Spaghetti screen out of the way and go to the desktop. Let's see. Where do we have Twitter? Yeah. Okay. I don't need to announce twice. So here we go. Obviously, I'm the developer, so I get this fancy little dashboard at the top, but you would probably just see the page. So it's bluetengu.itch.io project/spaghetti, and tried to keep it fairly close to the design of the game. Obviously, you can see the trailer over here if you want to. Threw in a few screenshots, and so let me go through it. I don't want this to be just a giant spammy advertisement, but it did work hard on this game for a year, so I need to give it its proper sales. As you know, Project Spaghetti is a top-down 2D cowboy shooter where the bullets fire and bounce around the screen is the pinball mechanic. As you've seen when you've watched me make it, you can use the bullets rebound mechanic to your advantage to rack up points, defeat enemies, loot the coins they drop for even more points, and you've seen me fight through, the cowboys, the ghosts, the scorpions, the aliens, and the regenerating snowmen. All of them do kind of test that mechanic in a different way. Like, for example, the scorpion, you can't hit it from the front. Aliens, you have to maneuver it so their shield goes down and then hit them. Snowmen, you have to either hit them fast or try to avoid them while you reload. Different things like that. Just tried to find all these different enemies that would kind of test that mechanic to the max. There are other ideas for other enemies. Like, for example, was it Bone Crusher? Somebody mentioned a predator enemy, for example, and it's like hearing that, it's like, oh, that would actually be an awesome test of it, because if an enemy kind of disappeared and reappeared, disappeared and reappeared here and there, it would definitely test that bullet mechanic, because for example, you wouldn't be able to have time to shoot the enemy after it shows up, so the whole thing would be to get as many bullets flying around the screen as possible. So that's actually a good enemy that's not in the game now. If it works out somehow, I would like to add that to the game. I don't want to break the game by adding new content because it is released, but it's something I'd like to think about. I think you've paid enough for the game without paying for DLC, so I'd want to add it without doing that, but not sure yet. But yes, and in addition to the normal enemies, there's giant bosses. Loaded it with secrets. There's keys that you can get from the bosses, obviously, to unlock, areas if you want to jump straight to the graveyard, things like that. But there's also a lot of other keys hidden throughout the game. Just to let you know, there's like gold keys, ruby keys, emerald keys, diamond keys, things like that. They all lead to different things, different bonuses, stuff like that, and just Easter eggs everywhere. Some of them are based on challenges, some of them are based on, I could send a code, for example, from bluetengu.com. But there's also the Twitch Unlimited mode, which is what we've been working on for the last month. Seem to have got it in. Like I mentioned before, the Twitch mode got me very nervous, because working on Twitch, on a Twitch mode. The problem is, obviously, I'm not the owner of Twitch. They don't ask my permission before they make changes or do take their servers down, things like that. So it's kind of scary to put a feature like that that depends on a third party in your game because things could happen. Earlier this week, I'm sure you all got the email. They mentioned that they're adding WebSocket support. When I first saw that email, all I saw was, we're moving to HTML5 and WebSockets, and I'm like, oh my. My face drained because I thought they were just suddenly making the switch from IRC to WebSockets, and I was like, well, there goes that feature. Thankfully, they're still keeping IRC, the WebSocket stuff they're phasing in. WebSockets, let's go over it. WebSockets, the difference between IRC and WebSockets. IRC is obviously a chat feature, but WebSockets is more of a kind of a direct connection. It goes straight over, like, the browser and everything else, so it's faster. I haven't got WebSockets over here in Japan yet. I'm sure we're the last people to get anything from Twitch because they said they'd phase it in for different people first. So if any of you have WebSockets and you're using it now, I'm kind of curious what that's like. But for example, Hitbox, another like live streaming service, does use WebSockets. Was trying to get it to work with Hitbox. Wasn't getting responses back from their server and stuff like that. So I kind of put that to the side. But that's something I'd also want to work on. And obviously now that Twitch has moved to WebSockets, adding that WebSocket support to Project Spaghetti would be something I'd want to do. But it was scary putting that feature in, but to be honest, this last month has been probably the most fun month, having you guys kind of interact and add enemies, add bullets, or not bullets, yeah, bullet drops, add bumpers, bring your bounty characters up, things like that. It was a lot of fun. And I didn't want to just take it out because I was scared of, what would happen with Twitch. But big disclaimer, if Twitch just suddenly decides to go bankrupt or take their servers down or decide to ditch IRC support before I have a chance to do WebSockets, that feature won't work. Won't break the game or do anything like that, but that feature would stop working until I could get it fixed again. System requirements. The YouTube description needs a link to the game site. Thank you, Jimorian. Yes, good. Yes, I don't know why that wasn't there. Yes, let's do that. Let's add that right here live. Grab it there. Okay, that should do it. Okay. Yes, thank you, Jim, for that spotting. Yes. Needed that other than the link in the video. But system requirements. Oh, and Pandabits, you bought the game already. Thank you, man. Thank you also, Pandabits, for being, a supporter of the show for so long, pretty much the whole season. I'm gonna do this episode as kind of a look back as well, so we'll talk about the good times we had back when we were trying to draw desert things and stuff like that back in November and October and things like that. But yes, thank you, Pandavids. I do appreciate it. One other thing about the game, I'm just one person. I have three computers in here. I have two note PCs and this PC. Obviously, I've tested it on all those systems. With the Note PCs, because they don't have modern graphics cards, had to turn particles off. That's when I first tested it on those Note PCs. That's what kind of inspired me to put that particles enabled disabled option in there, because particles are pretty heavy if your PC's not up to it. Obviously, most desktop PCs in the last couple of years are going to be able to handle it just fine. But an old Note PC is not designed for video games, obviously. So did have that option in there. If for some reason you do have like an old PC and it's kind of running a little slow, turn particles off. All it is just those like smoke effects and things like that. So it's not going to change the game. But I did want to put that in there to make sure that people with older PCs could still play the game, because it is a retro game. It feels silly to not be able to play the game on a reasonably old computer because it is retro. But system requirements, Windows XP related. I think this is just because Game Maker. A lot of these requirements are just because Game Maker, the thing I use to make the game, requires it. Windows XP or later. I'll try to move it on to other platforms as I can. I do have a Mac laptop that I could test a Mac build on. So maybe I could try to do that. I don't have a Unix system, so I can't test the Ubuntu thing. I don't even know if I pronounced that right, but I would love to make those versions, but unless I can at least test it and make sure that things aren't broken, I wouldn't want to put them up there, even if I can compile and make them. So right now it's just Windows. Maybe in the far, far future, Android and iOS, but that'd be the far, far future. Maybe the game doesn't even work with those kind of things. But you can use the keyboard mouse, mouse controller. You've seen me using those. DirectX 9 or later compatible graphics card with greater than 32 megabytes of memory. This is a game maker thing as well. DirectX 9 compatible sound card or integrated sound chip. And one thing I should mention about DirectX 9, the installer should have like the checkbox in the grayed out like DirectX install thing to automatically do it. But when I did install it on one of the Note PCs, I installed it and then it popped up and said the shader didn't compile and it wouldn't start, and it's like, whoa. The reason for that is for some reason DirectX 9 didn't install. If it's one of those things where even if you have DirectX 10 installed, you have to install DirectX 9. The installer should have done that automatically, but you know, that's a game maker thing. game maker can be kind of hit and miss with some of its stuff, let's be honest. But if you do have some message that pops up and says the shader not compiled or something, that is the problem. What you can do is search for DirectX 9 download and go to Microsoft's site, download it, install it, and you should be fine. It should be a file like dxwinsetup.exe. But a Bone Crusher drops by. Bone Crusher, that's good to see you, man. You are the only person I made a bounty character for who has not seen it. because you just happen to not be here the last couple of weeks. But Bone Crusher, yeah, you've been a great fan of the show, and like with Pandabits, Cirrus, Jimmorian, Decent Scrimp, and House of Klaus, I made you a character in the game. I wanted to ask you like what character you'd want, but since you weren't here, I just took the liberty of taking the bone image and giving you like a skeleton character that shows up in unlimited mode. So I'll try to get that character to show up for you. But thank you for picking up Project Spaghetti. I do appreciate it. And Pandabits asked a question about DirectX. If you have a more modern version of DirectX, you should be fine, but all DirectX 9 will do is you know, the installer should do it automatically, but it does probably need those libraries as well. So it won't downgrade your DirectX 10 or anything like that. It just installs 9 as well. But yeah, I think you do need it because otherwise the shader will not work. But it should have been automatic with the installation process, I hope. By the way, installation process, I'm not sure if you guys are already installing the game, but there's a license agreement thing that pops up in the front. It's convoluted, but you know, it's legal speak and all that, but I just had to cover my bases. The only reason is because I am an independent developer. Obviously, if someone were to come along, decompile the thing and sell it as their own stuff, you know, I'd have to have some reason, some basis for getting my due. But you know, the license agreement is not there to, you know, spy on you or, you know, give you these ridiculous terms or make you sell your soul or anything like that. It's just to try and cover my bases. Like for example, the Twitch thing. I can't be responsible, for example, if Twitch goes down. I can't take all that weight on my shoulders. So the license agreement is a bit long in the tooth. But you know, for example, there are things in there. I tried to make sure that you know, the things you can do are spelled out. But for example, let's plays, things like that. If you want to monetize your gameplay of Project Spaghetti, do it. It's you are free to do it. It is in the license agreement. It's in, I think it might be on the itch page, and I'm saying it verbally now. So in a court of law, if I decide later to come after you and say, you can't monetize my video, you have full legal right to say, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Give me my damages. So yeah, obviously, the whole thing about video games, I'm doing this on Twitch. If I don't support Twitch and the Let's Play culture, what am I doing here, for example? So I think, you know, games that don't support Let's Play monetization, that's crazy talk because people playing your game in front of other people, what better advertisement can you get? So why would any game developer stop that? Totally. Yeah, so Decent Scrimp said, don't sign it. It gives Tengu your soul. Decent Scrimp stops by. Yes, we've launched Project Spaghetti. Decent Scrimp knows contract law and can find that clause in there at the very end that says, disclaimer, Blue Tengu now owns your soul. No, there's nothing like that in there. Yes, yeah, PandaBits and Nintendo disagrees. Yeah. It's up to them. It's their business. It's their property. Of course, they have full right to say, don't make money off our stuff. Obviously, that's fine. Game companies with really fancy games, and obviously Nintendo has plenty of channels for advertising their games, so they don't need people to do it for them. Maybe they did, but well, besides the point. Why would you stop people from streaming your game? I have no idea. But here's the packages. I'm not sure which packages you guys get. Don't worry about it if you wanted to go with the cheaper one, but I appreciate it if you did go with the more expensive one. Whichever price point you decide to go with, there's two of them. You do get the full game and the manual, and because you're buying it early right now, it's only version 1.1 right now. There might be a few kinks in there, things like that. I wanted to at least kind of patch that up, give you a little thank you by having like one of the silver keys, the one that you basically get by completing the game. You just get that right off the bat. The install instructions are in there, but if you don't know what's going on, just let me know. But what that is it unlocks that outhouse on the right, which goes into unlimited mode so that you can do Twitch stuff right off the bat rather than having to play through the game once. The reason that unlimited mode is behind a locked door in the first place is because it doesn't make much sense. If the player is presented with two doors, they don't know which one to go through. If they go through the unlimited mode door first, obviously they're going to be very confused because enemies they've never seen before are just going to be showing up on top of each other and everything else. So that's why it's behind a locked door until you play through the whole game, just so that you have been able to defeat all the different enemies on your own before they start showing up en masse. But obviously you guys have seen all of the enemies. You kind of know what's up. So yeah, I locked it for you right off the bat. And then there's also the player's guide PDF. This is something I made, the last minute. So I did make it in Illustrator and tried to at least make it look nice, but it needs more graphics in it to kind of get that atmosphere across, but I will update that in the future. At least for now, it has all the instructions you need, a lot of the system stuff as well for playing the game. But you all know how to play the game. The extra version, obviously the full game, the early silver key, which gives you access to unlimited mode, the player's guide, and also it's one of those things where it's not super high value or anything because the soundtrack is rather short. Obviously, it's designed to be looping short kind of thing. Obviously, if you bought the original Zelda game soundtrack, there's not a lot to it, for example. It is just that kind of soundtrack, but I wanted to throw it in there. The official soundtrack in case you did want to play it, or use it in Let's Play videos or something like that for atmosphere, whatever. But there's also a Sapphire Chest Key. This is something I also added last week. I've been a busy Beaver Onyx this last week. You'll see when I go to the task list what was up. But I added a Sapphire Chest Key because I wanted to, give you a special thanks if you did chip in a little extra. Obviously, game development's tough nowadays because there's a lot of competition. There are a lot of great tools that put a lot of games out there. It's really hard to put out a game for a price that's actually going to reward you for the work you did. So I did, well, we'll talk about prices later, but I did want to at least give you a thank you if you did kind of pay the price. I wish I could charge people, but that's that. And I also, a link to the Lost Season 1 episode, just to let you know, this kind of ties in what happened at the season finale last week. And it also includes a key hint guide so you can find all of those secrets. It's not a direct guide, it's just kind of hints as to how to find this stuff. But it's just a link. The reason I didn't include the actual video is because itch.io doesn't allow you to include files that are over 500 megabytes. And, frankly, rather than downloading a video and having it on your hard drive, you probably would just rather have the link. So it's an unlisted video on YouTube, but the link is there. It's just kind of a little extra thank you I put together. And let me catch up since Decent Script did stop by. And Bone Crusher did mention, thanks, Blue. I will definitely be streaming your game if you have it set up on Twitch. Yes, it is set up on Twitch. As long as you put in your username, channel, your OAuth password, which I'll describe later, and all that, you should be able to stream from Twitch no problems. We've been doing it the last couple of weeks. It is in there. And with that early buyer silver key, you can go to it right away if you do want to. And I would definitely appreciate you guys streaming the game. Obviously, I don't have the advertising power of Nintendo or anything like that. And right now it's just a soft launch. I haven't tried advertising in different places or anything like that because I want you guys to be the first to have the game and play it out because you've been supporting me for so long. But yes, if you do stream, I think I'm subscribed to all of you guys, but you know, if I catch any of you streaming Project Spaghetti, I'll definitely try to stop by your stream. That would be awesome. And Decent Scrimp was asking Panda how things are. How's life been treating you? Found a bug. Oh my god. PandaBits found a bug. Oh, let me know what it is. That could be part of the show too, fixing bugs and getting it patched up. Hope it's okay. I have tested it on as many systems as I could, but yeah, there could be bugs in there. Definitely let me know. But background, obviously I did go over this at the beginning of the show, so I'm not gonna go through it too much, but obviously it was inspired, this game has been inspired by our undying love of the classic Commodore 64. Project Spaghetti was our first foray into game development as Blue Tengu. As I've said before, I've been a developer on teams before, been a, you know, a small part of the machine, but this is the first time I've had full control over the game. And for the last year, every week, as you know, we've come on to Twitch TV to show what we were making and how we're making it, in the hopes of providing a little entertainment value at the very least, and getting maybe some of you to go out and try game development yourself. Ah, yes, PandaBits, right-clicking while moving around with WASD. Yes, that's one of those things where it's like, yeah, I know that one is in there. I'll have to think about a way to get around it. That one's tricky because wasn't really expecting people to try and do multiple controls at the same time. Mouse and keyboard obviously works because you could do moving with the keyboard and mouse for like shooting and things like that, but obviously you can move with the mouse too. When those overlap, yeah, the problem is the speed up thing. Because the mouse move is saying move to a position in Game Maker, but the keyboard is also setting the speed, so it just makes you move really weird. But thank goodness it's not just like a crash bug or something like that. Whew. But yeah, I'm gonna have to think about a way to get around that. Yeah, and Panda said it's really good. It's so fast. Yeah, it, at least you know it does make the game. If anything, well, it doesn't make it easier because you're going super fast. You might run into a bullet, but I guess it's not a disadvantage, I guess. But you know, as I mentioned last week, we'll be kicking off season two with the new game. But you know, before I move on to season two and a new game, I do want to make sure that Project Spaghetti is enjoyable, as bug free as I can make it anyway, with you know the limitations I have in Game Maker, etc. Don't want to just move on to the next game and just say, eh, throw it out there, give me your money, I'm done. Yeah, I don't want to do that, obviously. So at least what I'm thinking at the moment is unless things unexpected things come up, maybe this month is going to be trying to take feedback, put it in there, like for example some of those things mentioned just now. One other bug I should mention as well that I'm aware of is if you're in full screen mode, this is a Game Maker thing. If you're in full screen mode and you start to try and put in like your Twitch password, username, all that stuff, I don't know why Game Maker does it this way, but they break you out of full screen mode and because they're using the Windows stuff. They break you out of full screen mode, the window pops up, and then your resolution's all messed up, so you have to go back into graphics and switch it off of full screen and back to full screen. So just to let you know, that bug is in there. The only thing it is a Game Maker thing, so the only way I can think of to get around it, I can't fix it because it's in Game Maker, but the only thing I can do is probably turn full screen off, then pop the message up, grab it, and then if you were in full screen before, put it back to full screen. It's not a deal, but it's the only way to do it. But those are two issues, definitely. The one PandaBits mentioned in that. If you do notice anything, definitely let us know. Obviously, you guys know all this stuff, so I won't go over that, but there we go. Bone Crusher asks, what are your plans for your next game? Yes, let's talk about that. The next game. Let's see. Still running around in my head quite a bit, but let's bust up good old-fashioned paintbrush and really do my idea service. Paintbrush is my equivalent of the cocktail napkin, but much, much worse because my mouse drawing skills are terrible. What I'm thinking right now is I do want to try and put a little more story into the game because, story is, as a game designer, one of the things I have done is scenario writing and stuff like that. So I do want to try to get a little more story in there. That doesn't mean I want text, text windows and screens and things like that. You get plenty of that through like the RPG Maker episodes that you see every week. I don't want to put a lot of text in there, but just more like atmospheric stuff. Obviously, Project Spaghetti, the story is you're looking for an outhouse. That's plenty for a retro game, but there are retro games with much much thinner motivations than that. Going to the bathroom is very important. But the next game I want it to be a little more atmospheric. What I'm thinking right now is over the last year, the full-time job that I do is helping other people make games. As I said, as a small piece of the machine. During that part-time job, sometimes it gets a little stressful. One of the best ways I have for relaxing is there's a r river right next to the office, and I go out there and there's lots of birds and everything else, and those birds have really like saved my soul over the last year. Just watching them, it's fascinating. I finally understand why people like bird watching because birds are fascinating. I guess everyone's kind of in a different place with animals and things like that, but some people like insects, some people like the other spectrum, which is close to humans, like monkeys and dogs and things like that. I like birds. They're kind of in that sweet spot. If I can put it that way. Let's see. We've got like your bug here. You got your bird here. You got your dog here. Just to show off my, I don't even know what that is. Lion, I guess. Let's call it a lion. Put little poofy things around it. And you got your like humans here. It's just in that kind of sweet spot where it's like you can look at them and you can kind of guess what they're thinking. You can kind of think, all right, this bird is here because I'm eating a sandwich and it's gonna call its friends as soon as I drop a crumb. And this bird's kind of disturbed because there's this pigeon over here. This sparrow is disturbed because there's this pigeon over here. This is going way off topic, by the way, but it has a point, so stick with me. But just watching birds interact with each other is fascinating, and it inspired me to do a bir game about birds. And it's not giving me a message. What is going on here? Interesting. Paintbrush has crashed. That is new. Oh, there we go. Paintbrush crashing. That's about right up there with Notepad crashing. Okay, well that's that. Let's try to bring up another paintbrush and see what happens. There we go. That is the first time I've had paintbrush crash on me. Be careful. Back up your horrible scribblings. Otherwise, you'll lose them. What I'm thinking is there is a game. Jimorian's going to know this game because we both played it a lot. But Blue Max on the Commodore 64 is going to be a lot of inspiration for this. In fact, let's not rely on my horrible drawing skills. Let's just find it. Commodore 64, Blue Max. I won't show a video because it might violate someone's copyright or whatever, but it'd be nice to see it in motion if someone has an animated GIF or something. But here's the game. You're basically, a pilot of an old B-wing going through it. Peter Adams, give him his props. Sinsoft. You're basically. Your plane is like this, and Jamorian pops in with, "Oh yeah, yes, we both know this game very, very well. It's very hard." But you have a plane. Let's see if I can get my hand in the camera. You have a plane, and despite the game not being 3D, you have altitude. If you pull back on the stick, you can go up. If you push forward, you can go down. If you go down too far, you crash, and there's a limit to how far up you can go. The great thing about this game was even though you didn't have 3D, it felt 3D because you had planes on different levels to you, and you knew you were on the same level based on like these colors that appeared at the bottom, like these like this blue means that you're on the same level, you're on a certain level that's able to shoot enemy planes and things like that. And you could bomb these buildings for points and try to get to the end and things like that. It was someone made a new version of it. I'll have to play that if it's free. But yeah, it's a great game. Very hard, but kind of using a similar concept with the birds. I do want to make altitude important, but I don't want to just copy Blue Max. There's a lot of other things I want to do with the game. One of the things I have in mind is birds. The interactions they have with each other are very interesting. So it would be interesting if you could make yourself kind of a sparrow. And you've got crows and enemy things like that. But I also want to make it more atmospheric, like I was saying with the story stuff. I want to have it, if I can pull it off, where it's kind of an open world. You start off as a bird and you're kind of wandering around. You can turn, you can fly, you can do all this stuff, you can go up and down in the altitude and all that. If you go close to the ground, I want the colors to kind of fade out, as kind of like to let you know how high you are in the sky. Have the colors bright and cheerful if you're at the top, and really dark and kind of gore, horror-esque at the bottom, and kind of show like maybe like a fallen human civilization or something as you're down there, and kind of throw an adventure aspect into it. Also, one other thing that I'm thinking of right now is to make it more interesting. Obviously, there's easy ways to do it. Like you could have a bird that just poops on everything. As Panda Bits mentioned with the book, everyone poops. Yes, that was actually one of your earlier ideas. There was a game. Let's while we're waxing nostalgic, Percy the Potty Pigeon. There we go. I was on the Spectrum and the C64, but Percy the Potty Pigeon. Yes, you are a bird that poops on things for points. There was that idea. Because Project Spaghetti is obviously kind of in that vein of humor, so it wouldn't have been that much of a departure to do that, but I did kind of move away from that. And I don't want a bird that just like shoots bullets because that's weird. So what I'm thinking right now is there's another game, which is probably going to be kind of an inspiration in this case. Man, this paintbrush thing is crazy. What is going on here? Yeah, I'm not sure why my computer's kind of dying on me with paintbrush, but Kix, this is another game that Jamorian will know. I guess there's no shoes called Kix, so that's gonna make this much harder to search for. Kix is another very great game that uses a simple mechanic to devastating effect. You have basically these little vector lines that kind of float around the screen, and your goal is to try and make these little squares where it's not going to interrupt you. If you're in the middle of making a line and this thing runs into it, you die. So you have to kind of piecemeal do these lines. If you take too long, these things start showing up and going after you like bombs and things like that. The interesting thing about this mechanic is that whole risk reward. I'm a big fan of risk reward. Rock, paper, scissors, risk reward, the foundation of video games. Kix has a great risk reward system. That risk reward is if you do try to draw a big line, you can get more points out of it if you complete that square, but you have a bigger risk of that thing running into your line and killing you. So I kind of want to put something like that in the game as well. So like if there's crows or something like this, if Decent Scrimp is in here, I think he was killed by a crow or something. You can't. I want you to be able to kind of circle these things, and that's how you get rid of them, or how you destroy them and get your points. So kind of a combination of Blue Max with kind of a circular kicks mechanic, things like that. This would probably also work better than, for example, Project Spaghetti on an Android or iPhone device as well, because you could theoretically use your finger to go up and down, circle, choose your direction, things like that. Project Spaghetti shooting's involved and ducking's involved. So yeah, it's possible to kind of emulate the mouse controls. But oh, what the heck? What is going on with my paintbrush? Come on. Come on. All right, so something must be loaded in the background. And Bone Crusher mentioned like Star Wars Battle of Hoth. Let me check that out. Oh, you mean the actual like Battle of Hoth from the movie, not like an actual video game? Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Bone Crusher, you came through with the perfect example. Battle of Hoth, yes. Oh, this is something I'm gonna have to blur out, or George Lucas is gonna try and sue me. Well, Disney, I guess now. He's gonna try and sue me. But yeah, the Battle of Hoth, where you're going around with like the speeders and trying to loop around the AT-ATs and stuff like that to take them down. Exactly that kind of concept of looping around something. And, if an AT-AT ran into your cable before you finished the loop, it would just toss you to the ground. Exactly that's the concept. Exactly. And Pandabit said, with the speed, you can kill yourself with a bullet you just shot, like literally faster than a speeding bullet. Yes, that is one drawback to that whole like WASD with mouse issue, is you can't run into your own bullets. So yeah, I'll see what I can do to address that. It is a game maker thing in some ways, but maybe I can get around it. We'll see. Maybe I can change some of the ordering around, or at least check maybe every frame to see if one of the keyboard movement things was used, and if it was used, drop the mouse move stuff. Maybe that's the easy way to do it. But Bone Crusher asks, that's what kind of game I wanted to make next, and that's what I'm kind of thinking of right now. Visual style. This is something I'm really kind of looking into right now. I can obviously go with the Commodore 64 palette again, which is fine. I love the Commodore 64 palette. I know how to work in it now. It would be very efficient for me to do that. But one thing about it, the one idea I do have is to go crazy with the visual style, do something different. Obviously, the bad thing about pixel art is, it's like drugs. Everyone's doing it nowadays, or something like that. It's hard to make your game stand out if it's pixel art, because, like I said, everyone's doing it. I love pixel art. It's fine. I think there's still plenty of possibilities for it. I think it's perfect for, people like me who aren't artists, to still make the game and get it out there to people in a way that's not visually unpleasing. For example, if I tried to do modeling, I would fail at it miserably. It would take me forever. Like, to make Project Spaghetti, it would probably take an extra 4 years to make it or something if I tried to do modeling. But one thing someone I know, like someone from my work, did mention an interesting idea, which would be to take a camera and, get like clay models or something and take pictures of those clay models and try to, get all the different angles and stuff and put those in the game. I'm not sure how Game Maker would support that. Obviously, if it was Unity, or Unreal, I would have no trouble putting those kind of models in. Game Maker, I'm not sure. But I think for the next game, I do want to stick with Game Maker, because, to be honest, the last year, it's been a lot of work. Even with Game Maker, because I am doing it all. Music, sound effects, that kind of stuff. Doing it all. Voice effects, everything. It's a lot of work. And Game Maker is just the right amount of tool to kind of get a game done in a year on your own. Unity, it's great. Unity is great to use. It's very powerful, but everything just takes a little more time to get done in Unity. It would obviously be able to handle 3D models and things like that. Problem, because it's designed for that. But I think it would just take me way too long to make the game. It would also probably not be very interesting for the show too. So I think I do want to stick with Game Maker, but I'm not sure about Game Maker's 3D support, how good it is, etc. I haven't looked into that because I've always thought of Game Maker as kind of a 2D game engine. And Bone Crusher mentioned, why not use the Game Boy palette? That would really test my art skills. By the way, I bashed on Nintendo a little bit earlier, but props to the people at Nintendo who put together games, awesome, awesome games on the Game Boy. Your artists deserve more than whatever they got for that gargantuan effort of making a game that makes sense with so few colors. And Pandabits mentioned, if you hit a boss with a bullet during Last Stand, are you supposed to not get up? This is for Project Spaghetti. Yeah, because the Last Stand bullet only revives you if you kill someone, but that's something I noticed playing through it too. Like, if you are going up against a boss, obviously there's nothing you can kill. So Last Stand just seems kind of weak in that case. So that might be a good feature. Let's go over to our task list and show you where we're at. This will be part of the look back, but when I first started a year ago, with Agile and everything else. I put together the plan, talked about burn down everything else with Agile. I'll go over that again because now it's time to do the look back in Agile terminology. But let's add some of these things. So bug move with keyboard and mouse at same time speeds things up too fast. Okay. And let me just put who it came from in the comments, if you don't mind. Just so I know, like, if I have someone to tell, hey, this got fixed, I know who to tell. That's one thing. The other thing is, yeah, let's boost that last stand mechanic. A hit against an enemy revives you. Yeah, let's make it so that a hit revives you instead of having to kill the enemy, because with most enemies, if you hit them with an exploding bullet, they're going to die. But there are two exceptions. Aliens, if you hit them while they're shielded, their shield's going to go down, so there's you're not going to survive last stand, and obviously the bosses. It would be more fun if you could hit and then revive. So let's do that. Pandabits also mentioned. You can still scoot around while dead. Oof. Yes, I think I did notice that once. Can still scoot while dead. Yeah, let's look into that one. That one's not good. I guess it could be kind of a feature because it allows you to maneuver into something where you can get that last stand mechanic. But while dead, while you're a corpse, that should not be happening. And also might be a good idea to put the reference and stuff at the top of the result screen. It's getting cut off routinely when I'm playing at full screen and near full screen. Okay, I'll have to look into that. That might be something where I need a screenshot to see kind of what you're talking about. But records, etc., get cut off at full screen because I didn't notice that on my system. So it might be something where it's different for different people's monitors. Yeah, so let's make sure those are all in the list. Yeah, and just to let you know, some of the other post-production tasks I'm thinking of, player color dependent on the number of power-ups. Like, for example, in unlimited mode, when you get boost and all these other things, I want to make sure the player color represents that. Right now, it represents kind of the combinations, but there are only so many colors to work with, so I can't represent all of the combinations. So it's probably just better to say how many power-ups you have and change the color based on that. An extra power up based on quick reload so that you don't have to wait for the reload. You know, that'd be a good power up for Twitch, for example. Key items drop special items early. Yeah, rather than forcing the player to enter a special room to get a key item, maybe just popping it in the level selection screen would be a good way to do it. And score, separate score for unlimited mode in the main game. Right now they're both shared, so the same high score goes across them both. That was the original design, but I think it might be better to split them up so you know which one's which. And as I mentioned just now, the full screen thing. Find a way around the Game Maker full screen glitch. That's one of the things we have to do. Okay, and Pandavits is streaming it, so this is going to be a bit surreal because I'm gonna watch Pandavits streaming as well. So this is going to be very fourth dimensional Twilight Zone. Twitch TV Pandavits. Did I want W's in there? No, I did not. There we go. So yes, viewer Pandavits has been with us a really long time, and if it's too hard. Perfect. I'm glad. I didn't want it to be too easy. And Cirrus, good to see you. Cirrus drops by, another viewer who has been with us for a really long time. We are launching Project Spaghetti. We have launched it. Showed the trailer and everything else. And yes, Cirrus warns me, don't look at the porn on Google. I'll try to hide that. I don't have the voice on because I didn't want my voice, you know, echoing, but let's turn it back on here. So this is surreal. This is Pandavits. By the way, check out Pandavits' stream. Follow him. He's awesome. I've definitely been a big fan of the show. So, okay, well he ran away from this image, but there we go. So I'll keep that up while I kind of talk about things, but I'll jump back to the task
I
list here
gotta
for a
make
bit.
it.
There we go.
so that when you see it, you see why it's a problem, as opposed to right now when it doesn't look like it's a problem.
Okay, yeah, so Pandabits is literally going to help me find this
It's
issue.
so slow.
Ah, that's the particle thing. Yes, the Game Maker particles are pretty heavy. If you go into graphics, options graphics, and disable particles,
Frames.
it should get a lot faster.
Okay, better.
So apologies for that. Yes. Okay. That's something where it's going to depend on the computer. I'm going to have to see if I can find a way to cut down on those particle processing stuff. Let's see if I can look into that. That's going to be a huge thing. Particles. Too heavy. One of the things I do want to do is make it so that you can turn the weather particles off, because those are the ones that are heavy. That smoke that rolls across the screen is what's heavy. There could be ways to get around that. So let's figure that out. Okay, so I'm going to jump off of Pandabits' stream for now. So thank you for playing. I don't want to see that stuff. Come on. Yeah, my computer's kind of dying here. Well, actually, let me keep Pandabits open. If my computer will let me. Yeah, it could just be like the graphics processor. It's taxing the weather particle effects are very taxing on the processor. So that's a bad thing. So definitely go into options and turn those off. I'll try to figure out a way to get those particles kind of down
Window
on the
mode.
CPU stuff. Okay. Well, I'll kind of keep Pandabits up there. Let's see. Okay, let's keep things moving. All right. So let's do the look back here. I'm gonna try to see how many okay well let's okay it's moving fast now. Good. All right, that's good to see. So I am gonna mute you,
Oh
sorry.
shit!
All right,
I
actually, if you
didn't
want to
make it
watch
go
this.
race but
Sorry guys, if you're watching this and getting confused by what's going on, it's
I mean
surreal.
I saw the evidence of it. But
Panovitz doing his best to take down the cowboy boss. I'm so used to the cowboy boss, I guess it's fine for me. All right, I'm sorry, guy. I'm gonna mute you so I can go through the task list a little bit here, but I'll definitely want to catch you guys streaming after the show. We started back with episode one way back a year ago, and over time, at first it was just when I was first getting the game started, I didn't want to skip things like do overtime and have things suddenly appear in the game, which is why. It's episode 1, 2, 3, and there's no overtime in between. But later on, there were things in here like fixing things, minor brush-up things, where it made sense to kind of just do it between shows. Later on, it was graphics, things like that. Obviously, after a couple of episodes, you've seen me draw 1,000 sprites and things like that, so it wasn't worth, showing that live and stuff like that. So that's why the show kind of evolved to be the way it did with episodes and overtime and things like that. Let's see. At last count, if I have it down here, week 50. Okay, that's how many tasks I have left. You know what? During one of the breaks, what I'll do is I'll calculate all of the time that went into making this game and see and check it out, because that's the point of an agile look back, to see how long things did take you, how different things, how long it took you versus how long you expected it to take, things like that, because that'll help me kind of making the next game too. But I am going to take a quick break. So, as this is kind of a special episode, Sirius, by the way, Bone Crusher as well, I should mention it's going to be a 4-hour episode because it's a launch and kind of a look back. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show that launch trailer again, And then show episode one of that animated show. See the humble beginnings of the show before everyone got abducted by the corporate windbags. And I'll probably, cover my breaks with a couple of those older episodes as well. Maybe in the coming weeks as well, kind of show the other ones. Because just to let you know, in the very beginning, pretty much no one was watching it. This was before Twitch had a game development tag. So I was just doing it under Project Spaghetti, which is a random game no one knows. Obviously, in the very beginning, the only person dropped by, I have to give his, I think it was a, yes. I have to give him his props. I didn't actually check gender. But Runic LP, and I always called him Runic Clip by mistake, but I think it was Runic LP. He was the only person who is dropping by in the very, very beginnings of the show. So I want to thank him as well for kind of keeping me company in the very beginning. Because to be honest, I started in July, and then July, August, September, up through September, Twitch did not have that game development tag. So during that time, it was either Runic LP, maybe a random person, or just me, literally. Literally talking to myself for 2 hours as I made a game. That was very lonely. And for a time, I was actually debating whether or not to switch from Twitch to like something like Hitbox, where maybe, because there was fewer streamers and things like that, maybe more people would drop by. Glad I stuck with Twitch because I got to meet PandaBits and Sirius and Bone Crusher and all of you guys, and Beaveronics as well. Got to meet all of you guys and see you guys. So I'm glad I stuck with Twitch. I'm glad Twitch came up with that game development tag. It has made a difference. Has helped. And to get an actual official Project Spaghetti tag, what I have to do is go over to Giant Bomb. I'm not sure if Decent Scrimp is still in here, but yes, Giant Bomb. Twitch uses the Giant Bomb database to figure out which games you can choose from that drop-down list. So I'm gonna have to add it to that. So that if you guys are streaming, you can use Project Spaghetti instead of having to type it in manually. There we go. But yes, in the very beginning, no one was around to watch it. So probably, unless you've gone back and watched the YouTube videos, you haven't seen most of these episodes where we first the first animated episodes. And PandaBits mentioned, I actually found this only because of a Kotaku article about the game development channel. Oh, okay. So the Kotaku article, I assume it didn't mention me. I guess I was too minor. I assume it mentioned the game development tag on Twitch, and then when you did the search, you just hap my page just happened to be there. I'd actually be kind of interested to hear how you guys all came across the channel, because that would help me maybe find some more people. That is going to be one of the difficult things going forward, is if there's a lot of people in here. Maybe it'll be hard to make a game, but we'll see. But that'll be more of the look back. So I do need to take a break. Because if I'm going for 4 hours, I definitely need to water my voice up. It's dying already. So the next 3 hours are going to be interesting. But gonna take a quick break. So I'm going to show that trailer and episode one.